It might seem funny, it might seem crazy, but if you met me today, you would probably not be surprised to learn that I know exactly where my self-published autobiography is in the U.S. Library of Congress. You see, it won an award from GANSPA in Atlanta last year. That would probably be because you may have said in one of the business sessions that I facilitate, or maybe you've saw one of the motivational videos I've posted on social media. You see, who I am today is very different from who I was before. In the words that the late Paul Harvey might use, I've come to tell you the rest of the story. It was Dennis Waitley that said, there are primarily two choices in life. One, to accept conditions as they exist, or to accept the responsibility for changing them. And if you understand the responsibility of those two choices, then you might be led to believe that to stay in dire circumstances is merely a matter of choice. However, my own life circumstances and my own life experiences have taught me it is impossible to understand and seek answers to questions you don't know exist. I come to you today to tell you about my life story. See, I remember that day. That day, that was the day that my life changed forever. It was Christmas Day, 1968. My dad came home and he said, my mother had died. You see, she was 33 years old and she had succumbed to a diagnosis of double pneumonia and what was labeled back then as the Hong Kong flu epidemic. The CDC said over 33,000 Americans had died between September 1968 and March 1969. She was 33 years old, and she had been sick for over a month. He had just taken her to the emergency room a couple of nights before. Her death meant that he, a 50-year-old man who before was a truck driver who moved from place to place with no real roots anywhere, was responsible for six minor children, ages 9 through 14. I was the 9-year-old. He was a caregiver in that he was a provider, but now he was responsible for our daily care. My dad was a proud man. He was a man who would rather raise his children, his family, in an inner city, shotgun-styled, cold house than to accept government assistance. You see, I can remember at the age of 12 going home with one of my friends to the Spencer Macaulay homes. I later learned that was the Alton Park Projects. And they had these things called food stamps. And I walked in the house, and the house was warm. And they had food stamps. And my friend said, oh, those things, they are free. You all ought to move out here with us. You see, these are free. And they had food and warmth. I went home to tell my dad. And I was so excited. And he waited for me to finish. And my dad looked at me very sternly. And he said, that's charity. We don't need that. You see, what I learned from my dad that day is if I wanted a good life, if I wanted to live well, then I would have to work for it. My dad was my life coach in that my dad told me that if I went and bought 5 pounds of chicken and 5 pounds of potatoes, I could have a different tasting meal every night, even in the lean times. We talked about everything. We talked about cars and tools and where he had been and what he had done. You see, where I lived, most of the people were in rentals. There was less than 10 people that owned their homes. So there were no meetings about building wealth or home ownership. You see, when no one comes around to take an inner city kid outside of their neighborhood, they tend to grow up to dream about what they see and who they see. My dad, for all the conversations we had, the one conversation we didn't have was about me being a girl. Back then, men didn't have those type of conversations with their daughters. And so I didn't know how to be a girl. The closest we got to that conversation was at the age of 13 when I went to announce to him that I was pregnant. But my dad, he did the same thing he said the same thing he said when we were on our way to the cemetery to bury my mother. I looked at him with tears in my eyes and I said, "What am I going to do?" And he, trying to muster up enough reassurance for me and for him, said, "We are going to make it." You see, from my dad, I learned that conversation, that he was my support system. And even when I messed up, that I could see past my circumstances if I was determined to see the other side. But for all the things that I learned from my dad, there was a hole in my education. That hole was so visible that in and out of my life, there were these random women that I honor and I respect and I cherish the relationships because they found themselves woven into the fabric of my life's path. They saw the gap in my education, and they chose to help me move forward with being a woman. And they understood it would take more effort than money. These women, these random women. There was Dorothy. Dorothy became my big sister through my church. She was assigned to me. And Dorothy allowed me to have experiences. Dorothy, she would tell me to dress up, and we would go have lunch at the Miller Brothers cafeteria. Dorothy would buy me little handkerchiefs or a pair of hose. Even though I was a teen mom, she never made me feel like I was a mistake or that I had made a mistake. She always helped me to understand social issues so that I could form an opinion. Dorothy helped me to understand music and different types of music so that I no longer just dance to the beat, but I understood music as far as what the composer was doing or what the songwriter meant. I felt their passion. You see, back in that day, in my neighborhood, our musical experience was going to the orchestra in school as a field trip. And then there was Miss Thelma Whitaker. Oh, Miss Thelma Whitaker was my 10th grade English teacher at D. Howard High School. She saw me as a teen mom trying to make it, trying to wrap my head around the experience. And she told me, just like my mom had told me, that education could push you forward and could change the compass of your life if you allowed it to. You see, Miss Whitaker saw me. And she made me feel special and gifted. She saw my potential. And it's her that I'm here when even today I'm studying for my master's. You see, Dorothy, those experiences taught me about home ownership because her family owned their homes. And I think about her when today I own two homes. You see, it's those things that every one of us have the potential of doing in the lives of an underserved child. It's taking them outside of their environment and giving them the opportunity to have hope and taking them to a place of opportunity. That's what I do when I'm trying to teach young people, when I'm talking to my children, my three sons, when I'm talking to them, I'm teaching them about responsibility and the power that's in their choices. I'm exposing them, I'm telling them the importance of education. I'm telling them that they're empowered to make good choices. I'm trying to be the example for them that someone was for me. I'm doing that with young people when I'm teaching them vision boards. I take them to that place where I received hope and the opportunity to dream. When I'm talking to business owners, those people who are dreamers, I'm giving them relatable stories so that the information becomes tangible to them. When I'm talking to teen moms, I'm telling teen moms that although their lives are different, that their lives are not over. I'm pouring into them like people poured into me, and I'm trying to give them back some of that self-esteem that life took away from them. You see, I'm telling them stories about my son that I had at 14. He's a captain at the fire department now, and he's a husband, and he's a father, and he's a grandfather. He's a business owner. I'm telling them they can make it. You see, I stand before you today, exposed, educated, empowered to recognize and use the power of my choices. Thank you.